The Bullard Knights are on the verge of making history under the Friday night lights. You see, no football team wearing the blue and white has ever gone undefeated. The Knights are just 2 wins away from adding their name to the record books. But as Ralph Gaston reports, standing in their way from advancing to the D1 championship game is the most storied program in Valley history, the Bakersfield Drillers.
It was a result no one was expecting, a result that changed the Division I bracket. The top-seeded Buchanan Bears, unbeaten through 10 games, saw their season end on the last-second field goal.
What stuck in my mind is to remind our kids to stay humble, because you let your guard down this time of year and you're one and done.
Not that the Knights needed more motivation. 2 more wins and they'll be section champs for the first time in school history. But to do it, they'll have to take out the section's most storied program.
Bakersfield has won more Valley Championships than any team in Central Section history, and our kids didn't understand it. When I threw the number out there, 35, I think that their eyes popped open.
But they do remember number 34. That's when the Drillers came to McLean Stadium in 2005 and beat Bullard to win the title.
Bakersfield and Bullard at the time, they were both huge teams.
I think Bullard was down by 1 touchdown at halftime, and we just couldn't capitalize, made a few mistakes.
I just remember, thinking after the game, are we going to get another crack at this? Because when you get there, you want to close the deal, because you never know how many chances you get.
Now the Knights have another shot. And with 2 more victories, this class can fulfill a promise they made to each other in the 7th grade.
Ever since, I think, middle school, we've been thinking Valley Championship, and the fact that it's so close, we're all really eager to get to it.
It'd be amazing just to end everything, getting the first Valley Championship in the school's history.
For 55 years, ever since the opening of Bullard High, the Northwest community had never seen the Knights win a Valley Championship in football. Over the decades, there had been some great teams with extraordinary players, teams that had come so close. In 1970, 75, and 2005, the Knights had made it to the Valley Finals only to be denied. So if the sidelines were filled on this evening with many of the faces from the past, Bullard Hall of Famers, alumni, coaching legends, their kids and grandkids, it only underscored their years of frustration. The Fresno Bee sports writer, tongue-in-cheek, had called Bullard's sideline crowd the entourage that had been growing each year as head coach Donnie Arax transformed the football program into a Central Section power. By 2009, no team in the San Joaquin Valley could match Bullard's devoted fan base. No Bullard team had done what the 2009 Fighting Knights had done. They were undefeated, a perfect 12-0, one victory away from history. But this was McLean Stadium, a field that carried a bit of a curse for the Knights. Just 4 years earlier, they had lost the Valley title by a touchdown to the Bakersfield Drillers. On this night, December 11, 2009, the forecast called for a hard rain. The Bullard faithful feared the weather might neutralize the Knights' athletic superiority against another team from Bakersfield, the surging Centennial Hawks. But if anyone thought the rain would keep away Bullard's fans, they were sorely mistaken. Coach Arax had marked this team of players ever since they landed at the campus of Tenaya Middle School. He knew they were a talented bunch, but he also knew they could be a handful, a collection of rogues and rascals. At Tenaya, the players were introduced to the Bullard way of football. An aggressive young coaching staff of former Knights players emphasized toughness and discipline. led by current Bullard coaches Armin Tarikian and Justin Vartanian. The future Knights recorded breakthrough victories over Clovis schools on their way to a second-place finish. The core group remained intact in 2006 as freshmen at Bullard in a season that provided a window into the future. Led by head coach Kevin Coughlin, in a year break from his duties as varsity offensive coordinator and defensive coordinator Steve Cox, the freshman group ran the table. Their 10-0 record was significant on many levels. It established an air of invincibility among the players. Most importantly, it re-energized the program coming off an embarrassing 2-8 season, 1 year after a Valley Championship appearance. In 2007, Coughlin returned to the varsity armed with several of his freshman stars, sophomores Caleb Justice, Daniel Snelling, Kyle Fela, Shelton Autry, Kyle Staples, and Mike Mendoza. Played key roles as the Knights rebounded with an 8-3 record. This collection of super softs brought energy and a winning attitude to a program at a critical crossroads in its development. 2008 was an even greater success. The Knights ended a 2-year County Metro Athletic Conference drought by defeating Edison for the league title on their way to a 9-3 record. Bullard players and coaches entered the offseason with a clear understanding that second best would not do in 2009. Talent and experience at key spots created unprecedented expectations in the community. To their credit, a seasoned coaching staff, many of whom had been there together the better part of a decade, embraced the added pressure. Coaches Kevin Coughlin, Brandon Gilbert, Joe Lee, Lloyd Ramirez, Kevin LaCroix, Yosef Fares, and Justin Vartanian formed the core of a staff that had been instrumental in transforming Bullard into an elite program. Like their players, they believed that success in 2009 would only be defined by the ultimate prize, a Valley title. Week 1, Merced. Quarterback Kurt Tobler and receiver Jawan Hammond picked up where they left off in 2008, and Bullard's defense lived up to the lofty preseason expectations. Before 3,000 fans at McLean Stadium, the number 2 Knights throttled San Joaquin Section Power Merced in the 2009 season opener. Tobler, a senior headed to Yale of the Ivy League, completed 13 of 16 for 319 yards and 2 touchdowns, in addition to 2 10-yard rushing touchdowns. His favorite target was the athletic junior Hammond, who went high in the air to snag several balls in a 6-catch, 163-yard evening. Senior David Rishi, another part of the deep corps of Knights receivers, pitched in with 3 catches for 76 yards. The Knights scored on their first 4 possessions using a mix of Tobler passes and runs by the backfield trio of Jordan Jones, Demetrius Warren, and Kyle Staples. Staples pounded for 2 scores, while running mates Jones and Warrens exploited the Bear defense for 156 yards. Springing this impressive collection of backs was an offensive line consisting of tight end Shelton Autry, tackles Kyle Fela, and Ricky Davis. Center Mike Mendoza and guards Enrique Solario, Nick Saito, and Alec LeMay. The Bullard defense was dominating from start to finish, limiting Merced to 97 yards. Defensive ends Bryce Contreras and Ian Tobler set the tone early by batting away several Merced passes in the first half. Linebackers Joseph Solis, Caleb Justice, and Staples led a front 7 that limited Merced to 24 yards rushing. Bullard coach Don Arax was particularly pleased with the performance considering the mental state of his Knights heading into the opener. Quote, "We had a shaky few weeks of practice," he said. "We've got a lot of experience back, and sometimes they started to tune out. But one thing about this group is their ability to turn it up on Friday nights. Tonight was a good example of that." Week 2, Atwater. For the second straight year, Bullard beat the Atwater Falcons in a week 1 non-league game. In the first meeting of the two programs at Chicansey Park in 2008, the Knights came away 36-15 winners. 2009 contest saw the Knights defense run its season-opening shutout streak to nearly 90 minutes as the Bullard offense showed off its strengths in both the passing and running games in a 35-12 rout. The game started slowly as neither team scored in the first quarter. On the first play of the second quarter, however, Kyle Staples rushed 1 yard for a touchdown and a 6-0 Bullard lead. Just 3 minutes later, Devin Mack rushed for his own 1 yard score, and when Kerr Tobler ran into the 2-point conversion, the Knights had a 14-0 lead. The defense did their part in the half, containing athletic Falcon quarterback Nathan Sanchez and allowing Atwater into the red zone only once while forcing 3 punts and 2 turnovers on downs. Bullard's offensive highlight of the game came on the final play of the first half. From their own 20, quarterback Tobler hit receiver Jawan Hammond at the 35. Hammond split the defensive backs and outran the Atwater defense for an 80-yard touchdown, the longest play from scrimmage of the year. With a 21-point lead to start the second half, the Knights turned into their ground game to control the clock. Jordan Jones, Demetrius Warren, and Devin Mack gained yards and bunches on the first drive, which culminated in Caleb Justice's first touchdown of the season on a 10-yard scamper. Bullard's final touchdown came on Mack's 30-yard run to start the fourth quarter. Brandon Gilbert's defense did the same in the third quarter as it did in the first two, holding Atwater to 44 yards and a punt and a turnover on downs on their 2 possessions. With their fate already sealed, the Falcons scored a rushing touchdown with just under 8 minutes left and a long passing TD in the final minute. Game 3, Clovis. In week 2, Bullard opened up a stretch of 4 straight games against rivals from Clovis Unified. The second-ranked Knights welcomed Clovis High to Chancy Park and stormed through the Cougars for a 48-14 non-league win. An aggressive defense led by 3-year starting linebackers Daniel Snelling and Caleb Justice recorded 6 sacks and limited the pass-happy Cougars to 245 yards on 46 attempts. Except for the final minutes when Clovis scored twice on the backups, the Knight defense on fire all night. Bullard defensive coordinator Brandon Gilbert attacked Clovis quarterback Trey Mitchell with an array of blitzes. His timing disrupted. Mitchell was forced to deliver the ball before route combinations could fully develop. Cougar receivers did Mitchell no favors by dropping several dead-on passes. The Knights secondary of Chris Tate, John Krantz, Chris Kelly, and John Jones was as solid as well, forcing Mitchell to work underneath for all of his yards. Offensively, Bullard put together its third consecutive explosive performance. The 3-0 Knights scored the first 3 times they had the ball on touchdown runs by Jordan Jones and Devin Mack, and a 23-yard pass play from Kurt Tobler to Chris Tate, and they never looked back. A 53-yard pass play from Tobler to Tate just before halftime set the stage for Caleb Justice's 8-yard scoring run, sending the Knights into the halftime break with a 28-0 lead. Quote, Clovis blitzed us a lot and we handled it very well, said Tobler. My receivers are awesome. I'm very lucky with the corps I have. Tobler threw for 285 yards with 6 of his 9 completions, going for at least 20 yards. Bullard receivers Tate, Kelly, Jawan Hammond compensated nicely for the absence of David Rishi, who was recovering from a hip flexor injury. With the victory against the Cougars, Bullard closes the decade 6-4 against the original Clovis schools. This was the first time since the 1960s when the Knights won 9 of 10 contests that Bullard had a winning record over Clovis in the decade. A month after the game, Clovis declined to renew the contract for 2010 and beyond, putting an abrupt end to a rivalry that had been played at least once every year since 1959. By the time the Cougars realized the magnitude of their decision, Bullard's non-league schedule for 2010 was full. Game 4, Clovis East. Bullard High turned the tables on Clovis East Friday night, unveiling their version of power football and routing the number 14 Timberwolves 52-14 at Chicchansey Park. Clovis East, the area's dominant rushing team over the past decade, saw itself upstaged by an emergent Knights ground game that had played a supporting role in a season-opening blowout to Merced, Atwater, and Clovis High. On this night, Bullard offensive coordinator Kevin Coghlan used quarterback Kurt Tobler and his talented collection of receivers as decoys, turning instead to a deep reserve of backs led by explosive sophomore Demetrius Warren and seniors Jordan Jones and Devin Mack. Coghlan focus on the middle of the East defense. Behind punishing isolation blocks by fullback Kyle Staples, Warren owned the early part of the game. His long run set up a 2-yard plunge by Staples that staked the Knights to an early 7-0 lead. On Bullard's second offensive possession, Warren put the Knights up 14-0 with a 2-yard touchdown run. The lead was increased to 17 just before the half on sophomore Sean Keeter's first varsity field goal, a 22-yarder. The second half belonged to Jones and Mack, operating out of the I formation. Both took turns running over East defenders as the Knights kept it simple with inside blast plays. Jones finished the night with 76 yards, including touchdown runs of 16 and 5 yards. Mack made the most of his 9 carries with 48 yards and 2 touchdowns of his own. The Knights defense, meanwhile, recorded its 4th consecutive strong performance. Defensive coach Justin Vartanian singled out linebackers Caleb Justice, Kyle Staples, and Daniel Snelling for praise. The trio of 3-year starters were instrumental in holding Clovis East to its lowest point total in the 7-year history of the rivalry. Defensive line coaches Joseph Fares, Lloyd Ramirez, and Donald Speed employed a steady rotation of defenders against the run-heavy Timberwolves. Mike Mendoza, Jonathan Williams, Shelton Autry, Nick Saito, Bryce Contreras, and Ian Tobler held their ground, allowing physical Knight backers to scrape downhill. Safeties Chris Kelly and John Kratz were instrumental in holding East quarterbacks Jerry Heyman and Daniel Corona to a dismal 4 yards passing on 11 attempts. Kelly also provided a highlight with a school record 99-yard kickoff return in the third quarter. Game 5, Clovis West. For years, Clovis Unified dominated Bullard's football program. Clovis High won all but 2 yearly contests from 1977 to 2003. Buchanan crushed the Knights in their first meeting in 2002 before barely losing the next year. Clovis East won the first 4 games against the Navy and Columbia. But possibly the biggest CUSD nemesis had been Clovis West. Beginning in 1982, the Golden Eagles won 20 straight games against Bullard with an average margin of victory of 22 points. That streak ended in thrilling fashion in the 2007 regular season game when Bullard scored late and blocked a last-second potential game-tying field goal, but C-Dub took the playoff game that year and both games in 2008. Another storyline was the bad blood between the teams stemming from the summer. During a Fresno State camp scrimmage, tempers flared and the teams ended up brawling. 6 seniors on Bullard's 2009 team were part of the 2007 win, and they knew they'd have to pull it off again to get respect from the rest of the Valley. The Knights visited Clovis West at Veterans Memorial Stadium on the Buchanan campus for their final non-league game of the season. And although the Golden Eagles made Bullard sweat for the first time in 2009, the Knights had enough to pull out a 28-21 win. The big story of the game was Bullard's defense. On Clovis West's first possession just after they crossed midfield, Chris Tate intercepted a John Kortoff pass. The Knight offense stalled just past the 50, but Spencer Mendoza's punt went out of bounds at the 9. On the ensuing play, Kortoff dropped the ball and Bryce Contreras recovered on the 7. From there, Kyle Staples and Jordan Jones alternated carries, which Staples carried the final yard for the first score after Martin Barman's extra point, a 7-0 lead. Other than Kendall Brock's 78-yard touchdown run on Clovis West's next possession and a long gain in the third quarter, the Knights defense shut down the Golden Eagle offense and carried the day. Bullard's offense continually ate up the clock with long drives characterized by tough runs and clutch passes. Bullard scored on another 1-yard touchdown run near the end of the first quarter. This time, Jordan Jones. Devin Mack added his touchdown on a 2-yard rush in the third quarter. The game went into the fourth quarter, all tied at 21. David Ricci ended a Clovis West drive by picking off a Connor Buss pass. And then with just a few minutes left to play, Buss overthrew another receiver. The ball went right to Bullard Jr. defensive back John Jones, who returned it to the 12. 4 rushing plays, including Jordan Jones' second 1-yard score of the game with 27 seconds left, put the Knights up by 7. The Golden Eagles only made it to the 41 before time ran out. And Bullard had just their second win over Clovis West since 1981. Game 6, Clovis North. Coming into Week 6, the start of league play, Bullard was 5-0 and still number 2 in the rankings. Where's the respect here? The Knights came home to Chicansey Park well-rested after a bye week to play one of the most anticipated games of the season. It was to be against the newest Clovis school, Clovis North. Although they didn't even have a senior class yet, the Broncos came into the season well-hyped after running roughshod over the competition at the freshman and JV levels the previous 2 years with legendary coach Tim Simons at the helm. Clovis North players and fans spent the summer and even the first few weeks of the regular season hiding behind online profiles while predicting they would end Bullard's perfect season, crush the CMAC, and win the D3 Valley Championship. When it came to the game, however, it was Clovis North that got crushed by the big hits of the swarming Knight D in Bullard's 42-0 homecoming victory. Bullard's defense occasionally bent and allowed the Broncos some passing yards. But in big moments, they held tough and repelled many Clovis North forays into Knight territory. The offense got things started with a 5-play, 80-yard drive after taking the opening kickoff. Kurt Tobler hit Jawan Hammond for gains of 17 and 55 yards. And then Tobler kept it himself for a 2-yard touchdown run. On Clovis North's 4th play of the game, Caleb Justice forced a fumble and Daniel Snelling recovered on the Bronco 45. The ensuing play saw Demetrius Warren take the handgun, turn the corner, and outrun the defense for Bullard's 2nd score of the game. The defense stayed active with Chris Kelly and Kyle Staples both intercepting passes and the unit forcing 3 punts and 4 turnovers on downs the rest of the game while keeping Clovis North off the scoreboard. Bullard scored twice in the 2nd quarter on Justice's 10-yard reception and Jordan Jones' run, both capped by extra points from sophomore Sean Keeter. The 2nd half went much the same as the early season blowouts, with Bullard controlling the 3rd quarter clock on 1 long drive, culminating in Jones' 2nd score of the game. The Knights' final score came on a quick 3-play, 70-yard drive. All 3 players were Tobler completions to different receivers that put a fitting end to the senior shredding of the North defense. He finished the game 9-14, 239 yards and 2 touchdowns, the final one coming on an 18-yard post to Hammond. The Bullard defense held Clovis North's running game, which had gained over 200 yards per game, to 86 yards on 29 rushes. Bronco quarterback Chris Mariscal to a 43% on his 42 passes. Game 7 Reilly. A week after throttling Clovis North, Bullard staved off a late Reilly rally to beat the Pirates 52-42. With some important players starting to go down because of injury, and despite nearly 300 yards and 4 touchdowns from elusive Pirate quarterback Richie Castile, the Knights used timely big plays on offense and defense and 2 kick return touchdowns to deny the upset. Running back Jordan Jones, who finished the day with 61 yards on just 8 carries, got things started with his first touchdown run just a few minutes into the game. Bullard and Reilly traded scores through the end of the half. The Knights went ahead with a 58-yard scoring pass from Kurt Tobler to David Ricci. Devin Mack's 5-yard run and sophomore Jare Hammond's 86-yard kick return, but Reilly continued to come back and tie the game. The half ended with Sean Keeter kicking a 34-yard field goal to give Bullard a 3-point lead. Don Arax's team started to pull away in the 3rd quarter, getting another Jones' touchdown run and keeping Reilly off the scoreboard. Jones' 3rd score of the game, with 8.5 minutes to play, gave Bullard a 17-point lead. Reilly scored twice within the last 2 minutes to make the score look closer than the game actually was. Ricci provided a 2nd highlight when he caught a perfect bounce on an onside kick and ran it back for a 51-yard touchdown. Game 8, Sanger. Despite missing 6 starters because of injuries, including senior quarterback Kurt Tobler and top receiving threat Jawan Hammond, the Knights found a way to beat the Sanger Apaches in Week 8 at Tom Flores Stadium. With the passing game not clicking on sophomore Ian Tobler's first start at quarterback, offensive coordinator Kevin Coughlin turned to his running backs to pound out yardage and eat the clock. Senior Devin Mack became the first Knight to rush for 100 yards in a game in 2009 by gaining 138 on 20 carries. His 31-yard touchdown in the third quarter put Bullard on the scoreboard, and he rushed 2 yards for another score in the fourth quarter to give his team their only lead of the game. Senior Jordan Jones rushed 10 times for 65 yards and a 28-yard touchdown that, coupled with Matt's two-point conversion rush, brought the Knights into a tie early in the final period. Brandon Gilbert's defense, missing four key starters, kept the Apaches out of the red zone all night. The only Sanger scores came on 95 and 22-yard runs. Even with the scare, the Knights improved to 8-0 on the season, with the big dates against crosstown rivals Edison and Hoover remaining in the regular season. Game 9, Edison. It was a scene that had played out before. An undefeated Bullard football team playing a late season game against a talented but somewhat underperforming Edison team. In 1981, Bullard cruised into the matchup 7-0 and number one in the Fresno B rankings after having dominated almost every game on the schedule. But Tim McDonald led the Tigers to a 41-36 upset. The 2007 Knights were also 7-0 and number one according to the B, but Edison dominated from start to finish in a 35-0 thrashing. In 2009, the addition possibly had more hype than any other game in the 50-year series. Bullard came in 8-0, number two in the rankings. Edison had a lot of talent, but had experienced some injuries to star players in previous weeks. During the summer, the two teams had scrimmaged and come away almost even, so everyone expected the game to be the same. And it was. After a back-and-forth defensive game, the teams ended regulation tied for the third time in their history. This time, however, overtime was played. That was a good thing for the Knights, who came away 9-0 after a 17-14 win. The defense had showed up strong in the first half, not allowing either offense inside the 25. Both teams turned the ball over twice and had trouble moving down the field. Bullard's defensive backfield held Edison's passing offense to 3 completions and 9 attempts in the first half, including an interception by senior Chris Kelly. The Knights defense stepped up early in the second half to get the scoring started. On Edison's third play, junior defensive back Chris Tate stepped in front of Max Shue pass at the Tiger 37 and ran it back for the touchdown. Soon, however, the Tigers started moving the ball. On their third drive of the half, they scored after a long completion, 3 rushing plays, and a Bullard penalty. After blocking a punt late in the quarter, Edison took advantage of the short field and athletic receiver to score again and go into the fourth quarter leading 14-7. Early in the final regulation period, however, Bullard got some long Jordan Jones gains and tied the game on a 14-yard Kurt Tobler to Chris Kelly touchdown pass. After the defense is held strong, with neither team scoring the rest of regulation, Kelly picked off his second pass of the game to end the final Edison plunge into Bullard territory, and the teams went into overtime. In the first OT, neither team moved the ball well. Bullard got to the 14 and attempted a field goal, but it was wide right. Edison took the ball and ended up losing ground because of penalty before a fourth down heave toward the end zone was batted away. The Knight defense held strong again in the second overtime, with the Tigers getting 6 yards before turning it over on downs. After getting a first down, the Bullard offense stalled at the 12, so sophomore kicker Sean Keeter was given another chance. This time, his kick was straight and true. The 29-yarder won the game for the Knights and clinched the CMAC title outright with one game remaining. Game 10, Hoover. 10-0, a perfect regular season, a feat not accomplished in Bullard's 54-year varsity football history. All they had to do to attain was go through their longtime rivals, the Hoover Patriots, in the traditional Battle of Barstow. Judging by 2008's 41-3 beating administered by the Knights, it seemed a win shouldn't be anything to worry about. But Hoover had improved in 2009, and Bullard was recovering from injuries. So overlooking the Patriots could lead to a repeat of 1978, when an underrated Bullard squad upset Hoover 6-0 for the only blemish on the Pats' 9-1 regular season. At the outset, it looked like Bullard might be in trouble, with Hoover all-around star Eric Kendricks suiting up and going through pre-game drills after missing some games with injury. But when the game started, Kendricks was on the sideline in sweats. Bullard sophomore Demetrius Warren had a breakout performance with his first career 100-yard rushing game. And once again, Brandon Gilbert's defense stood tall, allowing Hoover less than 200 total yards and just 6 offensive points. All of that added up to a 35-13 Bullard win. The Knights got the ball first, and offensive coordinator Kevin Coghlan went straight to Warren. He carried 4 times on the 6-play opening drive, including a 20-yard gain and then a 15-yard touchdown to finish it off. Hoover responded by taking the ensuing kickoff back for a touchdown. But then Knights took the ball right down the field. The big play was a 36-yard completion from quarterback Kurt Dobler to senior tight end Shelton Autry. Warren finished off the drive as well with a 10-yard touchdown scamper. The Patriots offense had the ball for a total of 3 plays in the first quarter, and their first 3 possessions ended in punts when they couldn't move the ball across midfield. Bullard extended its lead to 14 points in the second quarter on a 3-yard score by fullback Kyle Staples. Despite only gaining 28 yards in the first half, the Patriots put another score on the board with just over a minute to go. Starting a drive at Bullard's 21 after an interception, Hoover ran 4 running plays for short gains and benefited from a penalty on the Knights before scoring a 5-yard pass to go into the half trailing 21-13. Hoover came out in the second half sensing a comeback, and they drove the ball into Knight territory before fumbling it away. After that, Coghlan decided to stick with the ground game and grind out the clock. Big gains from Jordan Jones, Kyle Staples got Bullard to the 1-yard line, and Jones finished it off with 6 points. Hoover tried to get back into the game with the passing, but for the most part, the defensive backfield of David Ricci, John Jones, Chris Kelly, and Chris Tate shut down the receivers. The Patriots made it to the Knights' 20-yard line before stalling and turning it over on downs. And their final possession ended when Chris Tate picked off a pass in the end zone. Kyle Staples, meanwhile, put the final nail in the coffin late in the fourth quarter with his second 3-yard touchdown run of the game. And Sean Keeter's 5th successful extra point completed the scoring. While the coaching staff downplayed the accomplishment and looked forward to the playoffs, many community members and former players were ecstatic over Bullard's first undefeated varsity football season. It's playoff time, Clovis West quarterfinals. For the 3rd straight year, the Knights got a playoff date with their old nemesis from the Northeast. In 2007 and 2008, in the quarterfinals and semifinals respectively, the Clovis West Golden Eagles ended Bullard's season. The Eagles had come into both of those games as the hotter team and squeaked by the Knights. But 2009 was different. Clovis West was the 7th seed with a 5-5 record. Bullard, on the other hand, just finished a perfect regular season with the reward of the number 2 seed and the opportunity to host their quarterfinal match at McLean Stadium. On this night, the Bullard seniors, who had a 2-3 varsity record against the Golden Eagles, were determined not to let the Clovis West reputation and talent intimidate them and end their season for the 3rd year in a row. Bullard senior quarterback Kurt Dobler, coming off 2 less than spectacular performances while recovering from an injury to his throwing elbow, showed he was healthy and he knew how to step up when the circumstances required it. In easily one of the best games of his career, Dobler completed 12 of 16 for 185 yards and 3 touchdowns without an interception to lead the Knights to a 35-9 stomping of the rival Golden Eagles. It wasn't all Dobler. He had some help. Bullard's vaunted defense held Clovis West's talented running game to 50 yards on 19 carries and forced the Golden Eagles to the air. They gained some yards, but for the most part, it was too little, too late. The game started with a show of defense. Neither team moved the ball well, let alone put any points on the board in the first quarter. Early in the second period, Bullard marched to the Clovis West 13, but lost a fumble. After the Knight defense held, Bullard got the ball on its own 40. 4 runs later, they were into Clovis West territory. On a first down play, Tobler hit junior wide receiver Jawan Hammond in a stride for a 49-yard touchdown pass.
Pair of receivers to either side. Caleb Justice in the backfield with Tobler here on first down. Tobler drops back, throws. He's got Hammond, who's caught it at the 25, breaks a tackle at the 20. He will go. Touchdown, Bullard.
The game went into halftime 7-3 after the Golden Eagles kicked a field goal with just seconds left. At the beginning of the second half, the Bullard special teams decided to take it upon themselves to widen the lead. Clovis West got the ball to start the half, and after a three and out, went into punt formation.
Fourth and 12, they will punt it away. And it's blocked. It's blocked. It hits the official. It bounces
right
back to the Bullard Knight who blocked the ball. That is Daniel Snelling. He blocked it. It hit the referee. It came right back in his chest. He picked it up and took it in the end zone for a Bullard touchdown.
Bullard mixed runs and passes on the next few drives. Jordan Jones rushed 2 yards for a touchdown halfway through the third quarter. And on the next drive, Tobler hit tight end Shelton Autry for an 11-yard score. Just like that, the quarter ended with a 28-3 Bullard advantage. Clovis West scored on a touchdown pass in the fourth quarter, but by that time, the game was all but over. The Knights put the final points on the board with another Tobler to Hammond scoring pass, this time for 30 yards. Hammond finished with the contest of 10 catches, 169 yards, and 2 touchdowns. The 10 receptions became the fourth best single game mark in school history. The Bullard win ended Clovis West's season and moved the Knights into a semifinal date against one of the most storied programs in California high school football history, the Bakersfield Drillers. Final Four, semifinal Friday, Bakersfield. For the fourth time in 10 years, the Bullard Knights faced the vaunted Bakersfield Driller program in the playoffs. The Drillers had long been one of the premier teams in the state of California, with more than 30 Central Section titles and multiple state championships. One of the section titles came in 2005 when Bakersfield came into McLean Stadium and upset the favored Knights. The two teams also met in 2008 quarterfinals, with the Knights winning handedly 35-14. Many believe this Driller team very much improved, and the semifinal at McLean Stadium was expected to be a great matchup. The Bullard offense showed off right out of the gate. After taking the opening kickoff, they drove to the Bakersfield 39, where quarterback Kurt Tobler hit receiver Jawan Hammond with a touchdown pass. A John Jones interception got the ball back for the Knights, and after Bakersfield was penalized for being offsides, Devin Mack took a handoff, went right up the middle, and broke into the clear, down the field, and the left sideline for a 60-yard touchdown. Bakersfield defense stiffened after that, not allowing Bullard any points until the fourth quarter. Once again, Bullard's defense, led by starting senior linebacking core of Daniel Snelling, Caleb Justice, and Kyle Staples, shut down the opposing offense. After the Knights went up 14-0, Bakersfield came back down into the Bullard red zone. But quarterback Brian Burrell was hit behind the line by defensive lineman Bryce Contreras and a 4th-and-1 attempt from the 14. Just before the half, Bakersfield drove again. But Burrell lofted a pass toward the 5-yard line, and defensive back Chris Tate intercepted it to end the threat. The Brandon Gilbert, Justin Vartanian, Yosef Fares, Team DeMichelli, and Lloyd Rivera's coach defense came out with one of the same in the second half. Snelling almost had a pick six on Bakersfield's 25. Then the Knights recovered a Burrell fumble at the Bakersfield 22. 3 plays later, just a few seconds into the fourth quarter, sophomore kicker Sean Keeter made it a 17-0 Bullard lead when he booted a 36-yard field goal. 2 minutes later, the Drillers went on the board with a 45-yard touchdown pass. It was the first time the entire season that the Bullard defense got beat over the top. Things started to get a little hairy when Bakersfield got the ball back and kicked a 30-yard field goal with 5 minutes remaining, pulling them within 7 points. In crunch time, offensive coordinator Kevin Coughlin decided to go to his big running back to eat up the clock. Devin Mack carried the ball 8 straight plays as the Knights offense marched to the Bakersfield 13 before turning the ball over on downs with less than 30 seconds left in the game. With the Bullard defense dropping 8 men and rushing just 3, All Baker still could do was throw it up and hope for a miracle. Finally, on a fourth and down with just seconds remaining, Burrell's pass was intercepted just across midfield by Chris Kelly. Kelly weaved his way down the field and around would-be tacklers and dove into the end zone with no time on the clock, putting the final exclamation point on Bullard's 23-10 victory. Championship Friday, Bullard Centennial for all the marbles. The goal was within reach. In the 54-year history of Bullard varsity football, though many great teams and players, not one had won a Central Section Championship. Three squads, 1970, 1975, and 2005, had made it this far, only to lose heartbreakers and finish with the dreaded title of runner-ups. But going back to their Tenaya days, the Bullard seniors had been looking forward to their chance to make history. The coaches and community had also been eyeing this day with their special team. None of them were going to let December 11, 2009 pass without hoisting the championship plaque. On that rainy Friday night, with spectators packing the stands and even the sidelines hoping to see history, the Centennial Golden Hawks invaded McLean Stadium looking to upset the Knights. Centennial started the playoffs as the 8th seed and dispatched Clovis East before beating number one Buchanan on a last-second field goal. They defeated crosstown rival Liberty in the semifinals to earn the Valley Championship matchup and were coming in on fire with one of the best quarterbacks in California, junior Cody Kessler. After the pregame hoopla, Bullard's Chris Kelly took the kickoff back to his own 48. On the first play, offensive coordinator Kevin Coghlan decided to set the tone for the game with
Kyle Staples will be in at fullback. Jordan Jones will start at halfback, a receiver to either side. Hammond comes in motion this way. They fake it to him. They're going to look downfield for Rishi. Going deep on first down. Rishi's got it at the 10. He's going in, and it's a touchdown for the Knights on the first play of the game.
They fake the reverse to Hammond, and then they've got Rishi coming across the middle on a deep post. That reverse drew the free safety.
Centennial wasn't going to go quietly. On their second drive, Kessler showed why he's considered a top college talent, completing 7 of 9 passes while eluding rushers. The Golden Hawks capped off the drive with a 16-yard touchdown pass, though the extra point, no good to keep the score tied at 6. The Knights scored again early in the second quarter when Jordan Jones capped a long drive with a 1-yard touchdown plunge, after which Tobler ran in the 2-point conversion for an 8-point lead. Centennial came right back with a field goal, and on Bullard's next possession, intercepted a deflected pass, ran it back for a touchdown. After the two-point pass, the Golden Hogs were up 17-14 with just over 6 minutes left in the half. When the Knights got the ball back, they went to the air for the majority of a 14-play drive. Tobler hit Rishi and Jawan Hammond three times each and then capped it off with two passes to Kelly, the final one being a 13-yard completion to the center of the end zone for a 21-17 halftime lead. The second half started with almost the same fireworks as the first. Bullard's kickoff was short, so the Centennial returner got a running start, caught the ball, found a hole, and went into coverage for a 75-yard touchdown return. Bullard's offense proceeded to go three and out, but the defense stepped up on Centennial's third play.
Third and three here, handoff to Moore in the backfield. He fumbled again, and it's picked up by Snellick. He's on the move. 30, 20, 10, 5, touchdown! Touchdown, Kessler caught up to him at the one, but Snellick dived into the end zone, and it's a touchdown for Bullard.
Bullard had a strong drive going into the beginning of the fourth quarter, and just a minute and a half into the final period, Tobler and Hammond connected on their familiar jump ball. After the defensive back tipped the ball, Hammond stayed with it and waltzed into the end zone to complete a 29-yard scoring play. The Bullard defense once again stood tall, kept Centennial from scoring, and the Knights offense got the ball back with a chance to do one of the things they do best, run out the clock. Devin Mack, the truck, got the call on six of the first seven plays and delivered with 64 yards, including a 35-yard scamper to the Centennial 12-yard line. Quarterback Tobler ended the drive with a one-yard touchdown dive. And with that score, the final 4 minutes of the game were just a formality. Centennial drove into the Knights red zone, but failed to score because of three incompletions and a timely sack of Kessler by sophomore defensive end Ian Tobler. With just a few minutes left, the Golden Hawks got the ball back again, and as they drove for a meaningless final minute score, students and fans started jumping out of the stands and crowding the sidelines to prepare to celebrate history. Finally, the Bullard offense got the ball back and got into victory formation with just under 20 seconds left.
Well, they're going to have to take a knee one more time here. Victory formation for Bullard. Tobler takes the snap, takes a knee, and that'll do it. 16 seconds ticking off the clock. Arax and the team coming on the field. And, folks, the Bullard Knights are Division I Valley champions as they win it 42-31.
And the crowd counted down the final seconds of one of the longest, most agonizing droughts in area sports history. Bullard beat Centennial 42-31 to cap off the greatest season in school history. 13-0, Valley Champions.
A man walks down the street, he says, why am I soft in the middle now? Why am I soft in the middle? The rest of my life is so hard, I need a photo opportunity. I want a shot of redemption. Don't want to end up a cartoon in a cartoon graveyard. Bone digger, dogs in the moonlight. Far away, my well-lit door. Mr. Beer Melly, get these mutts away from me, you know. I don't find this stuff amusing anymore. If you be my bodyguard, I can be your long-lost pal. I can call you Betty. Betty, when you call me, you can call me out. A man walks down the street, he says, why am I short of attention? Got a short little span of attention, and oh, my nights are so long. Where's my wife and family? What if I die here? Who'll be my role model now that my role model is gone? He ducked back down the alley with some roly-poly little bat-faced girl. All incidents and accidents, there were hints and allegations. If you'll be my bodyguard, I can be your long lost pal. I can call you Betty, and Betty, when you call me, you can call me out. Call me out. speak language. He holds no currency. He is a foreign man. He is surrounded by the sound, sound. Cattle in the marketplace, scatterings and orphanages. He looks around, around. He sees angels in the architecture, spinning in infinity. He says, amen, hallelujah. If you would be my bodyguard,
I'm in the end zone, throw the ball, you know that I'm open.